Hi, HR Nation, it's Chris Rainey. Welcome to HR Leaders, the show where we interview today's most successful and innovative HR practitioners 5 days a week. Today, I'm joined by Jin Van Horst, Director of Learning and Development, EMEA and Latin America at Johnson Controls. Jin, welcome to the show. How are you?
Thank you, Chris, for having me.
Thanks for coming on. Jin, before we jump in, tell our listeners a little bit about yourself personally and your journey to where we are today.
My name is Jin Van Horst. I'm 58 years young. I live in the Netherlands. I'm a father of two sons. I really like to sport, trail running. I'm a drummer as well. I have a big drum kit, a Yamaha drum kit in my kitchen, which is...
I'm sure your wife must love that.
I just wanted to say that. That's the favorite instrument of my wife. I also like to do karate, martial arts. I'm a black belt. And yeah, that's a little bit about myself.
Wow, you were born to be in the learning and development world. Because clearly your passion is to learn and develop yourself. So tell us a bit more about your personal career. Where did that start? How did you kind of get into this world of HR and learning development?
It started when I was 19 years old. I had to go into the army. It was a drafted solution in the Netherlands. You were enlisted in the army, and I joined the army. And I went abroad. I went to Lebanon, stayed there for a couple of months. At that time, we had the invasion of Israel. For very old listeners, they may remember. But I stayed in the army because I could... Identify myself with it, and I thought that this would be a fantastic role to develop myself. So I stayed almost 19 years in the Dutch Army, and my last position was with the Red Berets in the Netherlands, and I stayed there for 8 years, and in 1999 I left the Dutch Army. I had several tours abroad. In the meantime, I was married, had two children, and I wanted to spend a little bit more time with my family and my children rather than going on, let's say, missions frequently. And therefore, I decided to leave the army and go back to school again. So I did my bachelor's, I did my master's, did another certificate degree as well. So that took me about 8 years. And in the meantime, I also worked with different companies. I started with a small consultancy company in the Netherlands, and then I moved up to Atos Origin. At that time, it was Atos Origin. Now I think it's Atos.
Yep.
Then I moved into the financial world in ABN AMRO and ING, and where I stayed about 9 years. And then now since 2 years, I work at Johnson Controls. So that's in a nutshell my career.
Amazing. But well, where did the decision to go down the learning and development route, where did that start?
Basically in the army, because I was an instructor. I started to train soldiers. And there the interest of learning and development already started, because you have to deal with grown-ups. These people are, let's say, 90 years and older. Which is a different way of developing people than, let's say, in elementary school, which was, let's say, the first getting to know learning and development in your childhood. But being an instructor, and especially in the beginning, when I was, let's say, a starting instructor as a sergeant, you know, you have to deal with people who are not always willing to learn and develop themselves because they were drafted into the military.
Well, yeah, very interesting. Yeah, of course. They didn't have a choice, right?
No, exactly. So they were not always highly motivated, I would say. Later on, the Dutch received a more professional army, similar to the British. But yeah, in the beginning, it was a little bit different. So you had to really motivate people.
What do you think that you took away that transferred well to help you in your corporate career?
Well, first of all, I think the skills that I've gained in the army is really hang in there. Whatever comes up, you know, if there is a budget constraint, people leaving, or restructuring coming up, always have a positive outlook. I think when the tough gets going, you really go on. So the perseverance, I would say, is one of the things.
And the resilience as well, right?
And resilience as well, yeah. So that is what I gained in the military.
Yeah. I think the reason I ask is that I always used to hire former military into our sales teams. And they were some of the most successful employees I've ever managed. And even to this day, some of my best friends, they've gone on to run their own multi-million pound businesses. And that's exactly one of the things that I identified in them, is that resilience. You know, I had a Israeli armed forces, former Israeli armed forces medic on my team. And if you imagine the things that he's seen on the battlefield, right? So when you're in a sales team and everyone's thinking that they're stressed and it's a very difficult day, he's just laughing at them saying, you know, because the things, the experiences that he's been through, that the resilience that he's built from, you know, being in the army, there's really nothing he feels he can't overcome at this point. And I really saw it in him, and I was fascinated by it to see him perform, because sales is a very unusual role where, you know, you get rejected 3, 4, 5, 6 times a day. People say no. You're calling people to sell them solutions and you're getting no, constant rejection, right? So there's many people that can't deal with that. You know, people aren't used to being rejected multiple times on a daily basis. They take it personally, you know, they get very stressed out. And that was one of the reasons why we lost talent, because they couldn't deal with that rejection. Right. And I found that people from a competitive background, or for example, if a lot of people that played sports and they were used to losing, that was part of their DNA. Losing and winning was, you know, came hand in hand. And similar with people came from a military background, they all came with this resilience in our team, and they just overcame any obstacle that they had in their career. And even to this day now, it's something I look for when I'm trying to recruit people, is that where have they had to overcome resilience in their career or in their life, to be honest, before, because that directly will impact how they work in our office. So where we are now, obviously the world of L&D is changed so dramatically, right? With technology. What really occupies your mind on a day-to-day basis?
I'm currently involved in a senior leadership development program for senior managers and directors in our company. And this is a global program, so it's not only my responsibility within EMEA and LATAM, but also Asia Pacific and North America. And we are currently training about 180 of these directors on technology. And one of the things that I designed in this program is, maybe you have heard about the book, The Fourth Industrial Revolution.
I haven't read it, but I have heard of it, yes.
Yeah, so that's a book from Professor Klaus Schwab. And he wrote in his book, let's say, the trends and the big shifts that are going on currently on technology. Also the dangers that are coming up in relating to the Internet of Things and technology. So in this program, which we designed, we have embedded this book for these directors. We also have added a college from the IE University in Madrid, using the WOW room. It's a fascinating, I would say, video wall of possibilities. So people can attend this classroom. It's a webcast. But you can also identify the state of mind of the people who participate in this classroom, because there's facial recognition software embedded. So I can see on the screen how people are doing in this classroom. Are they engaged?
Wow.
Are they bored?
Wow.
Are they, you know, I can say to the participants, you may think that this is future. You may think that it is a long way until this new technology comes into the workplace, but guess what? It's already here, and the university is already using it. So it's really helping them become more aware about the speed of the technology that is coming into the workplace currently. And technology is, within Johnson Controls, our core business. I need to be sure that the senior leaders are fully aware about technology, because they will become the decision makers soon And yep. then a youngster from university enters the company with software or new hardware or things that maybe surprises us all. And they have to say, yes, we're going to invest in this or not.
Yeah, especially with Generation Z entering the workplace.
Yeah.
It's going to be a very different world. Just for everyone listening, because I think everyone agrees with you, I'm sure, as well. But many of you that I speak to struggle to make this business case in their organization to get investment. So just going back a moment, what was mm-hmm. the process that you went through leading up to this to make a business case for yeah. this transformation? What did that look like?
If you just look at your own business, and if you, I'm not sure if the listeners are familiar with Johnson Controls, but we are big in building solutions for, I would say, businesses. We built the NATO building in Europe. And especially the hardware related to it. So we are involved in the security systems to get into the building. We are involved in the fire systems. We are involved in the air conditioning. And so we are really building smart buildings, making sure that energy does not get wasted. Lighting is on, a temperature at the right degrees. Mm-hmm. So we are really looking at creating a smart building and maybe also looking at smart cities. Technology is one of our core assets. That makes it easier.
That's true.
If you are yeah. having a company
yeah.
to build a business case for technology, because
you have to reflect that internally in your own exactly. culture and your own business. Yeah. How long are you into this new project?
So we are now rolling this whole new concept this year. So we start in February next month.
Oh, okay.
And we're going to use the IE WOW room in February. And the first face-to-face sessions will start in March. We decided not only to have them in a virtual classroom, but also to bring them together in face-to-face sessions. Mm-hmm. In classroom sessions, and we decided to let them go through EMEA as well. So they will attend one session in, for example, Birmingham in England,
yep.
one session in Bratislava, and one session in Dubai. So we're bringing them from all three regions into Europe, Middle East, and Africa, so that they are also familiar with different cultures. And because in the near future, these people could have been appointed to another role in a different culture other than they are working in right now. So I want to make sure that they are prepared, that they can see other cultures as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's very important. I don't think companies really prepare their leaders for that change.
I agree with you, because I came across a lot of senior leaders who'd never been, for example, been in the Middle East. Or vice versa, people from the Middle East have never been into the UK.
It's a huge culture shift.
I know.
Yeah. So what does the project look like, the landscape, in terms of the different modules or the different areas that you're going to be covering of your leaders mm-hmm. over the next 6 months?
So this is a six-month program.
Six-month program, okay.
Yeah. We start with a kickoff, a virtual call. Of course, we have a business sponsor, and that's in general a vice president in the company. After the kickoff call, they receive coaching. Mm-hmm. We start with the coaching.
Is that one-on-one or a mixture of mm-hmm. one-on-one? Okay, great.
One-on-one. Mm-hmm. After the coaching session, they will start on their project. They will get an assignment they have to work on in a group, mm-hmm. an additional project on their own.
Okay.
So they have to work on a project related to the book from the Fourth Industrial Revolution from Professor Klaus Schwab. Mm-hmm. And they have to pick a topic that is close to their heart. There are 14 topics in that book, and they can pick either.
Oh, great.
But the most important part is that they start thinking about the impact of this topic that is close to their heart. And also, if they can see or identify a way of making a business case to make it profitable for our company.
Great. So you're embedding innovation and product development into the learning.
Exactly. So we built entrepreneurism, I would say, into this topic as well, so that these senior leaders can see, hey, this is an interesting topic. I can see that in BMS, or I can see that in, in HVAC or in other areas that we are in. And they can build a business case, and then we can also offer this to our customers.
Wow.
And that way, the program also brings money back to the business.
So that's fantastic. I'm glad I asked that question now, because that directly is going to come back to the bottom line of the business. And also at the same time, it's going to really engage the leaders in the process, because they can see the impact that they're going to personally have on the organization and what they're contributing, right?
Exactly, exactly. And the fantastic thing is, at the end of the 6 months, they have to present this research paper to the business, to a business panel.
Who makes up that business panel?
So the business sponsor, who is a VP, he or she will invite his leadership team. So okay. There will be a business panel of 4 to 6 people. Mm-hmm. And then when the group returns, I'm talking about a group of 20 people, they will present that paper to that business panel. And they will immediately decide, okay, this is a go-ahead. Mm-hmm. We will continue to work on this. Or this is something that we will further investigate, or basically will stop. So it's going to be start, stop, or continue.
What was the reaction of the leadership team when you first presented this to them? Because I'm sure many of them were already excited, but I'm sure there were some people that were thinking, how do I manage this with my day-to-day responsibilities? I'm sure not everyone was completely by it, right?
The reality. That would be an ideal world, I would say.
So what was the reaction, and then kind of how did you overcome that with those leaders?
Yeah, this is the first time that we are going to do this in this way. So this is a brand new topic. I know that our CEO, George Oliver, is really into technology. It's our core business. He always says, mm-hmm. you know, technology is our business. We are not a business of just HVAC or building technology. Technology, that's our core. If you look at the way that people are participating in this program, you can really see, okay, I can learn something from it. I can contribute to this program, but I can also receive a lot of this program, not only because they will have interactions with senior leadership. They will be working on face-to-face sessions. So they will work with a group of 20 people, and that will extend their network. They will work on a social platform as well. And in that social platform, we offer them videos. We offer them guidelines, templates, assignments. Mm-hmm. They have to provide proof to us as well. So we are not accepting, okay, so did you read that book?
That's what I was going to ask. How are you monitoring?
Prove it to me.
So you've got the social learning element, but then how are you tracking the progress? Is it something you've built bespoke, that app, or is it something that you've purchased or brought in a company?
We purchased it, let's say, it's not a big social platform. It's called Jubi, G-U-B-I. That's a social platform that we use in between the face-to-face sessions. Mm-hmm. And there people can work together. They can ask for a peer coach on that as well. Mm-hmm. So let's assume, Chris, you and I are working on an assignment together. I've created a kind of a paper, or I have written a reflection on something. Then I can ask you, Chris, to give me some feedback on my paper, right. and you can ask me to give you. So we are working, let's say, even virtually together, and I can basically decide, okay, for this paper I want to hire Chris or ask him for feedback, and on the other one I can ask Jim to give feedback. So you know, you can identify who is more suitable for this piece of. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's a fantastic opportunity. We really looked at a blended solution. We looked at, is it meaningful for the participants, and is it meaningful for the business? And is it related to a business problem? And I think that should always be the first question.
Yes, because sometimes you can get carried away and go into, you know, 20, 30 different areas, whereas you have to ask yourself the question all the time, what does this mean for the business? Is it solving a challenge or helping your organization? So what advice would you give to other HR leaders listening who are thinking about creating a similar or strategy or project for a team, you know, you've kind of gone through the planning stage now. I'm sure you learned a lot. You've learned a lot going through that planning stage of how to put this together and create a business case. What advice would you give to the listeners out there who are planning to do something similar?
I think many of your listeners will already know, but always start what kind of problem are we going to solve? Mm-hmm. How does the world look like after this program? You know, what have we trained our participants? What kind of business problems have we solved? How much engagement have we created? How long have these people are staying currently in the company? And can we also retain them? Mm-hmm. Because that's the investment that we are taking for the next few years. I remember I worked at ING. That's a Dutch bank, quite a large bank, and we had
know them very well.
Yeah,
we just got back. We just got back from ING. We had a workshop with Hein Knappen.
Hein Knappen. Yes.
He hosted our workshop a few months ago.
Oh, fantastic!
Yeah, great guy, great company.
And we had at that time also a very high potential talent program. Mm-hmm. And that cost quite a lot of money. And I also noticed that sometimes these people who we invested a lot of money just left. You really want to make sure that when you spend a lot of money on these talents, that you can retain them for the company.
Yeah.
So one of the measurements.
Didn't mean to talk to you. Carry on. Sorry.
So one of the measurements I always look at, you know, and that's part of the return on investment, I would say, is after a year when they finalize this program, ask them, go back to them, and ask them, okay, did you receive a promotion? Are these people still in the company? Are these people still highly engaged? You know, are they using the content and the learnings that they have received in this program also to the benefit of their subordinates, mm-hmm. so that they can co-develop and co-deliver the parts that they received to their subordinates, mm-hmm. so that they can inspire their own people as well?
Yeah. Because of course that's the impact you want, right? You want that to filter down
absolutely
into the business. That's the whole goal of it, right?
Or absolutely. One of the
key goals of it, yeah.
Don't keep this for yourself. Mm-hmm. That's really important, and that's basically also the attitude that we want to give to the participants. Do not keep this for yourself. This valuable information, spread the news, and do the same exercises that we do in the classroom. Do this also with your employees.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's very important. One thing I loved about your program, because I've heard many of these programs being developed by both our members and speakers and people that mm-hmm. I connect with on a day-to-day basis, but I love the way that you've connected it with the individual of what it means for them. Because a lot of time there's so much focus on what it means for the business, but you've done a lot of work focusing on what it means for you as a person being a part of it, both personally, professionally, for their own personal development, and letting them understand that this is the impact that you're having on our organization. And this is what it means. And I love that part. And I think so many companies fall down and miss that part. And that's when people become disengaged and leave the business, like you said, well. Whereas if they feel like they're really personally developing and connecting with, as you said, connecting with key stakeholders in the business, and they feel a really part of that journey, then amazing things happen.
Yeah, so one of the things, if I can give you an example, Chris.
Sure.
One of the things I looked at is, let's assume we have a person working on, let's take a very simple topic, which is a thermometer. Everybody has a thermometer in his house. Mm-hmm. One of the things that that we offer in the US, so it's not available in Europe, but in the US, we offer a smart thermometer. Mm-hmm. And thermometers in the US are a little bit different than in Europe because they don't have radiators. They have a different system. It's a little bit detailed, but the thing with a smart thermometer is that it's connected to the internet.
Yep.
So updates come automatically. There is a microphone in that system, so you can talk to it, similar to like Alexa. In the near future, we see a lot of opportunities with this device. To connect it also, for example, to your camera system in the house so that you can look at your little child, or you can also look at what's going on outside your house. So it's a security system. So as a topic from the fourth industrial revolution, you might think, okay, I'm working on thermometers in my company. I would like to investigate if this smart thermostat can also be something more than just a thermostat. Mm-hmm. So you are researching and looking at these things, and then you come across, hey, security can also be used in this system. So via a few simple software updates or hardware updates, you can enrich this simple device into a much more home security device.
Yeah.
And that's the business that I would like to see, that people think on a more strategically way so that they can see the simple thermostat as a much more home security system. Maybe that's a good business for us. Let's pursue this. And then we can give this idea back to the business, and this will pay for our program. That's an example that...
It's a great example, and it's so exciting because we know, and I realized early on, that some of the best ideas that I've ever received in my business are from the people on the ground level who are working on a day-to-day basis. And the best innovation comes from the people that may not be in the product team or in your innovation team. It's the people doing the job on a day-to-day basis who don't have all of the noise, and they can look mm-hmm. at it objectively from their perspective and find those solutions and those pain points that they have. So, you know, the fact that you're embedding that innovation and that product development into the program is going to give you an immediate return on investment. So it's not going to be difficult for companies to go to their senior leadership team and pitch this to them if they have it from that perspective. I think we should embed that into all of our training programs and all of our projects that we have to make sure it's always aligned with the benefit of the organization. Well, look, Jim, before we wrap up, we're going to jump into the quick fire round. I'm going to ask you five questions, and you have no longer than a few minutes to give us some answers. Are you ready? What was the number one thing that was holding you back from becoming a leader in your field?
If your own manager or your own leader does not trust you, or there's a lack of trust, you really feel that you're hitting a barrier. I always give, at least to my team, the space to make mistakes, to learn from it, and to move on, and persevere, I would say.
What's the best piece of business advice you've ever received?
Always give three options. I would say if you have a business case, or if you have a question to ask to your manager or to your business leader, always give them three options so that they can decide themselves, give them ownership. Mm-hmm. But you dictate the three options.
I love that. It's so good. You know, I use that similarly, but I do normally, I call it the alternate close. It's more like I use it mainly in sales, right? Where I give two options that I want, but I let the person make the decision. So they feel like they're making a decision. That's a great piece of advice for everyone. But now, unfortunately, my wife she's clocked onto it now. So she goes to me whenever I try to get my own way, I give her multiple decisions. She's like, but they're all decisions you want, Chris. Don't try. She's recognized my strategy. So great piece of advice though for everyone. And especially when you're coming back to your leaders, you know, you have to come with a solution, not a problem, right? So giving them free solutions is definitely a great piece of advice. What's one book? I will link in the book that you mentioned earlier, but are there any other books that you would recommend to our audience?
One on emotional intelligence is from Adele Lynn. Is a book that I would recommend. Emotional intelligence is one of the topics that is, I would say, highly recommended for senior leaders, because we really focus on business solutions, business finance, financial decisions, etc. But sometimes giving this message in a more empathic way will gain much more hearts than normally.
Fantastic. And could you share some internet resources or online resources that you use personally for your own development or to stay up to date with current events?
Well, I'm currently doing an MBA at in the Netherlands, and as I mentioned before, I'm 50 years old, 58 years old. I have my master's, I did my bachelor's and other studies as well. But I try to do every 3 to 5 years, I try to do something more meaningful, and meaningful in the sense of, you know, doing a deeper learning. To really reinvent myself, but also to keep on track. So in this MBO that I'm currently doing, I was never into supply chain management. And this is one of the topics that I learned now in my MBA. So yeah, it broadened my horizon. It's not that I will frequently use this or whatever, but it gives me a different view on the world.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. And again, it's you're in the perfect role, right? You have that hunger for learning and personal
stay
development.
Stay curious. I always say stay curious.
Mm-hmm. What are some of the online websites or companies, media companies that you use, apps personally, to on a daily basis?
Yeah, I would say Brandon Hall, ATD. These are, let's say, the more obvious, but also e-learning for kids. Mm-hmm. That's an initiative I support from my good friend Nick van Dam. He is a professor at IE and professor at Nijenrode. He is a very well-known speaker, author of many books on learning and development. But he is also, and I think that is something that you have as well, Chris, and I really would like to follow on as well, is that we also give something back to the community. And Nick has a fantastic foundation, which is e-learning for kids, which supports learning and development in areas where people do not have, let's say, all the equipment that we have, and all the money spent and all the e-learning modules have been created. Nick,
amazing. Yeah, I'll definitely link that up. I'll find that and link that in the description for everyone. Fantastic. And then last question is, what's one thing about your business that you're most excited about?
That is a really difficult question because, as I mentioned before, I really enjoy my job. I think I have an amazing team that I work with. I have a team in England and I have a team in LATAM. I have a team in Germany as well. Without these talents, without their knowledge, their eagerness, their willingness to run the extra mile, we would not be in the position that we are currently in. So select the right people around you, also being a little bit different than yourself, that not everybody's saying yes when you say yes.
Yep.
You need the person who say maybe, or even the people who say no.
Challenge you.
Mm-hmm. And but also have other skills next to you and not always have copy of yourselves in your team. Going back to your question, if you have your team gathered around you, then whatever you must do for your work, if it's a building, if it's power solutions or whatever topic that you have to deliver in your business, together with your team, you can master and solve the business problems.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic. Well, look, Jim, you're giving us some great actionable advice, and I'm really excited to share your journey and your current projects and your insights with our listeners. So thank you so much for joining us on the show. Before we part ways, what's one parting piece of advice that you'd give to our listeners? And also, what's the best way for, if they have any questions or love to reach out to you, what's the best way for them to get in contact with you and learn more about your work?
Yeah, I have a website, so there's an email address on this as well. It's quite easy, jimvanhulst.nl. Mm-hmm. And there's an email address on that as well, so people can then contact with me. I would like to keep that a little bit separated, not that I take big pride of, but I give, let's say, some free advice on this website for people who are, let's say, do not have big budgets like our company has or bigger companies have. But sometimes people would like to have some advice, and I give that for
That's
free.
That's amazing, Jim.
You know, to have a little bit of a mentor. I think I have the age to have a serious mentor role.
Yeah.
But if I can help or support a few young listeners, I'm happy to do that, Chris.
Fantastic. And any parting piece of advice for our listeners?
Stay curious. Always stay curious.
Fantastic. Well, look, thank you again for joining us. Everyone listening, as always, guys, head over to our website, hrdleaders.com. You'll find the show notes from the episode. All of the resources and everything that Jim's mentioned will be linked in the description for all of you guys. Apart from that, Jim, thank you again for sharing your journey and experience with our listeners. And I wish you all the best until we next speak.
Thank you, Chris, for having me on the show. Have a great day.